Hi, my name is Jelena Vuckovic. I'm a professor of electrical engineering at Stanford University. My research is focused on experimental nanophotonics, quantum optics, and we're trying to make optical devices efficient and small and compact and integrated for many applications that range from secure communications, quantum communications, all the way to medicine. This conference is outside of the main scope of my research because I focus on photonics and optics, as I already mentioned, but certainly to implement the structures that we're working on, we have to use various lithographical tools and advanced lithography methods, so this is where the overlap comes. And especially some of the new structures that we're designing at the moment that we're trying to implement to be more efficient and more compact bring with themselves some new lithographic challenges, and they're interesting on their own, both to the community working on lithography and fabrication, but also to the IC community that is trying to incorporate optics on chips. So typically in the optoelectronics, people have been designing components using only a very limited number of parameters. So they typically start from structures that they know perform okay, and then tune few parameters until they make them better, and then they stop. And obviously this process doesn't explore the full parameter space. It explores only a few parameters. There is no guarantee that structures have optimal performance, and in fact, none of them have optimal performance. They just work well enough, but they're terribly sensitive to any imperfections in fabrication, temperature variations, and so on. They also have very large footprints, so they're not really very practical to incorporate with electronics. What we're trying to do is go outside of that mode of designing only few parameters and ending with suboptimal structures. In fact, we're trying to optimize the structures using a full parameter space. So we start with a black box. We only specify desired performance of our device, and then let the computer travel through that full parameter space until it reaches the solution that works in the way we wanted it. And we can, in the process, restrict the footprint, introduce robustness to certain typical fabrication errors or temperature variations and so on. We can also introduce limitations in terms of what are the smallest features that we can incorporate and so on. And what is very interesting is that the structures that we end up with at the end don't look like anything we've seen before. They're completely non-intuitive, but they have way better performance than the structures that we studied in the past, right? So they don't look like regular geometric shapes. They look sort of like Swiss cheese, but they have footprints that are tens or 100 times smaller than the structures with similar performance we know of. They're robust to fabrication errors. They're robust to temperature variations, and they're completely fabricable. Of course, some of them bring with themselves some new challenges in fabrication and lithography, and this is where I connect with the community that attends this conference. All of them sort of look like Swiss cheese, right? But if you pay attention, they're all very different. There are subtle differences between them. So they all look like some patterns of holes, but irregular holes, some of them connected, some of them disconnected, inside of a slab of silicon. There are many different functions that they enable. In fact, you can design a structure to perform any mapping between input and output optical modes, and that's how any linear optical device works, right? So essentially you can design any linear optical device, and what you will end up with some subtle pattern of holes inside of a block of silicon. So the functions which we designed so far include wavelength division, multiplexing, demultiplexing components, where you're splitting different colors in a very compact footprint that is 100 times smaller than typical footprint you would use for similar performance. And on top of that, we design structures to be robust and broadband, which is not what we have today, right, in standard optoelectronic devices. We can split different modes, different field patterns from the input channel into different output channels. We can route different input channels to different output channels. We have also designed structures where we couple from off-chip, from a fiber to on-chip guides. We can also map some free space modes into output free space modes, which would be interesting for mask design. So it's not only restricted to on-chip photonics. It is also applicable to biophotonics, to optical lithography masks design, and many other areas. We really are pursuing the approach in which we're trying to build all of the components of these optics on a chip in such a way that they can be fabricated using the same process that people use to fabricate electronics. You don't have to do any extra bonding or gluing at the very end, which makes the process slower and tedious. So we try to do everything in silicon and germanium, standard electronics materials. We try to take as little footprint and real estate as possible. We try to make them not sensitive to processors next door that heat up and increase the temperature. So we really try to live in the environment that is set up by electronics that is already working very well there. When would you see this in practical computers? It's hard to say. I mean, we already have some proof of concept demonstrations incorporating optics, but they're not really as efficient as they can be. So hopefully structures like this would be one day very soon on computers that we carry around with ourselves, not only in data centers, right? I believe it is a complementary technology in a sense that it's the next logical step that you have to take in order to overcome the limitations that we have in terms of losses and speed, right? So that's really natural progression of that everyone in electronics community has to take, right? But at the same time, it is disruptive in a sense that some of the things that we're developing right now could play a role in the areas beyond optical interconnects, right? So we're not really working on optical interconnects exclusively. Same structures that we're developing for optical interconnects could be incorporated as intracellular sensors. There is no way to sense what's going on inside of a cell without destroying cell today. So in medicine, it could be disruptive. It could also be disruptive in secure communications. We're developing building blocks for secure communication systems, right, where you can detect if whether eavesdropper is present. So that's clearly a new disruptive technology, right? But then at the same time, in computing, in development of a computing hardware, it is a complementary technology.